And listen, Sean Payton trading up to go get J.J. McCarthy seems like an excellent marriage. That seems like some kid who can take the tough coaching from Harbaugh, Sean Payton in the Bill Parcells mode, and also an accurate passer, something that Drew Brees, we all know, is. And we always, with Sean Payton, we always assume he's looking for the next Drew Brees. You know, I kind of dig that idea, Matt. I'm sure Denver would too.
Yeah, and that was honestly that went into it of who is someone that Sean Payton's going to sit with for 15 minutes and think, this guy can handle me. And if you can be coached by Jim Harbaugh for 3 years, I think you can handle Sean Payton as well. Some of the stories about the way Payton has coached in Denver, I think is a little bit new for some people. But I think J.J. could absolutely withstand that and thrive in that environment. But also, he is that timing-based passer who has poise. He has instincts. Now, there's a throw against Ohio State that I'm sure you have memorized where the linebacker's head is turned around and J.J. throws it right at that linebacker, knowing he's not going to get his head around. And his player is able to make a great catch on that ball. That's the stuff that I think Sean Payton's going to see and think, not only is J.J. mobile, which is really important for his offense, but he's coachable. And to some degree, you know, he's going to go out there and run the offense that you tell him to run. There's not going to be a lot of ad-libbing early in his career because he's been coached by a Jim Harbaugh who says, here's the offense. As you mentioned, Rich, we might run the ball 30 times in a row, but we're going to win, and that's all that matters. I think J.J. and Sean Payton is really a perfect marriage in terms of personalities and also play style within the offense.
And then I guess in the category, Matt, of you can't make this up, the fact that J.J. McCarthy would be the fourth quarterback in a row taken and a team trades up to go get him, leaving Jim Harbaugh to be able to get Marvin Harrison Jr. to start off his return to the National Football League from Ohio State is something you cannot make up, you know? That would be something else. Certainly sending Keenan Allen to Chicago, Mike Williams walks to the Jets. There's Marvin Harrison Jr. for Justin Herbert and his new offense. That would be something else, right? I mean, that's exactly, outside of trading the pick, which the Chargers might consider doing, that's what I was hearing at the combine, that's what they wanted the most. But this would be the dream scenario for the Chargers. They don't need a quarterback. Four other quarterback needy teams take one, and he gets Marvin Harrison Jr. as the de facto first overall pick of the non-quarterback draft. You know?
Yeah, it's perfect. It's storybook. And I, you know, it would be, does Harbaugh take an Ohio State player, though? I think that would be the question. Sure. Could he do it?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, Matt. You know, Matt, absolutely he could do it. Those days are over. He's turned the page. It's gone. He can absolutely do it. And who knows better on how difficult it would be to stop Marvin Harrison and what his game is and what it means for an offense than the guy who tried to stop it and successfully did, quite frankly, it all said and done by winning. But that's just, that's the aside. But absolutely, right, Matt, he would do it in a heartbeat. No question.
And it would be perfect for Harbaugh. And I think the question, if it goes like this, comes down to Harrison or Joe Alt, the tackle from Notre Dame. And you know, there's a great argument to be had for both players. But I think looking at this from a team-building standpoint, Marvin Harrison Jr. and Justin Herbert is – that is the matchup you want, especially if you're Justin Herbert. You're probably looking at your wide receiver room right now wondering, what are we doing? Where am I supposed to go with the ball? Especially, you know, they even lose tight end Gerald Everett, who is a really valuable, you know, passing game weapon. You lose Austin Eckler, very valuable in the passing game. So replacing some of those targets with a Marvin Harrison Jr., who is, every time I watch him, I think that's Larry Fitzgerald in today's game. You know, 6'3", 210 pounds, 4.4 speed, beautiful ability to run routes, to adjust to the ball. And he's pro-ready right now. He's been pro-ready, you know, probably since he came out of high school. So that is, if you're Justin Herbert, that's the pick I think that you're advocating for. I've heard the trade down talk as well. I think that was before some of the free agency and salary cap things happened. But if I'm a Chargers fan, this is what I want. I want four quarterbacks in the top four, which maybe that's why Harbaugh keeps telling everyone JJ is the greatest quarterback of all time. It's because he wants someone to do this. But
it's a win-win.
Yeah, it's really good politicking if that's the case.
No doubt. I mean, McCarthy gets pushed up. Solidifies his reputation as a quarterback whisperer, and then of course he winds up with Marvin Harrison Jr. And if I may put my draft analyst hat on for just a quick second and roster building hat on for just a quick second, Joe Alt's not a left tackle, I mean, not a right tackle. He's a left tackle. Yep. And they got Rashawn Slater there. So they're not going to go. And the one thing that everyone was talking about at the combine during the workout is that when Alt had to sort of act like a right tackle with the drills on the field, he didn't look nearly the same as he did as a left tackle, which makes complete sense. Where do you stand on Malik Nabers versus Marvin Harrison Jr.? Because, you know, that's a conversation we're hearing a little bit right now. And the kid lit it up at the LSU Pro Day. Where do you stand on that, Matt?
I still think Harrison's better. They're both great. And it goes down to the, you know, the flavor of ice cream analogy that we all use for scouting is they're all really good. It's just what flavor do you want? And I think it'll come down to scheme fit. Nabers is, you know, 70% of his production was in the slot, whereas Harrison and Rome Odunze from Washington are true outside X wide receivers. So it is going to depend on what you want at that position. But Nabers plays like he has a jetpack on. I mean, you know, we talk so much about comparisons. I've heard DJ Moore. I've heard Steve Smith. I've heard Tyreek Hill from NFL Evaluator. So, you know, the explosion that he has is rare. We did see that at the Pro Day with the 4.35 unofficial, the 42-inch vertical. At 199 pounds, this is not Xavier Worthy weighing $165 running a 4.2. It's a little bit different when you're at 199 pounds. But he's built like a running back who plays like a wide receiver, which is perfect for today's game where you want to get the ball out to the boundary, let guys create in space. That's his game. So I know, you know, it's been heavily reported. You know, I was even saying this back in the Senior Bowl. There are teams that believe Malik Nabers is the best wide receiver in this class. There are teams that believe he's the best player in this class. Now, those teams don't need a wide receiver, or excuse me, they don't need a quarterback, so they're able to say that. But, you know, it will be, I think, certainly an interesting decision, whether it's at 5 or 6 with the New York Giants or on down the line whenever that first receiver does come off the board. It's going to be interesting to see which of the two or even which of the three, if you throw Odunze in there, are going to be that first player to come off.
Catch the Rich Eisen Show every single day on the Roku channel, 12 to 3 Eastern, for free.